Well, maybe you could tell us a little bit about the individual, Donald Triplett, who frames your book and was to be featured.
When Karen Zucker and I decided to try to discover the history of autism, which we didn't know when we began, we didn't know what its parameters were or its depth or how far back it went or anything like that, which is why when we told our editors that we would write the book in 2 years, we made a big mistake because it took us 7 years. We went back and looked for, we thought an interesting place to start the book would be with the story of the first child ever diagnosed. And we could find his name because in 1943, a psychiatrist at Johns Hopkins University published the first article fully describing the syndrome that he had discovered in a number of children. At that point in 1943, he wrote about 11 children. But the very first one he wrote about, and he called him Case One, Donald, was a boy who was born in 1933 in Mississippi and came from a little town there called Forest. And he was very, very intrigued by and puzzled by Donald, this little boy, by then a young man. When he first saw him in 1938, was brought by his parents by train from Forest, Mississippi, long train ride through the South up to Johns Hopkins. And he spent 10 days under study and observation there. And what Dr. Connor knew at this point is that he was presented with something he hadn't seen before. Donald was not some of the things that other doctors had thought. He was not deaf, and that was thought because he didn't respond to his parents' voice when they called him. And he was not intellectually disabled because he had an amazing memory. For example, he could name all of the presidents of the United States, and the day that he was taught the alphabet, he immediately recited it backwards. He could recite the questions and answers of the Protestant Catechism. And one day, his mother sat down and played some Christmas carols. He'd never heard them before, and after that, he walked through the house singing all of them word for word. This kid was not intellectually disabled. He had an amazing memory. But at the same time, his social connectedness to his parents looked non-existent. He never cried for his mother. He never responded to his father's voice. He didn't respond to his own name. He was only apparently interested in objects and spinning things and lining things up. He needed everything to be the same. If he and his mom walked down the street to go to town on the sidewalk, he had to put his foot in exactly the same place he had put it on the previous trip. These were all very rigid behaviors, and they didn't know what was going on with their son. And neither, by the way, did Dr. Connors. So he saw Donald in 1938. He wrote about him 5 years later in 1943, by which time he had seen 10 other children. And what he said in his first paper is, I'm describing something that's never been seen before. And he used the adjective autistic to describe them. And autistic was a term borrowed from schizophrenia, which meant a sort of social withdrawal into the self. Autism, that word auto, like automobile, automatic self, comes from the Greek word self, self-driven. And so we told that story, including the fact that his parents had first institutionalized him when he was 3 years old, which is what people were told to do in those days. But his mom, or maybe his dad, we're not sure, just rebelled against that after a year. And they went to the institution and said, we're taking him back. And the director said, leave him alone. Everybody's better off this way. And they refused. So they went and got him help. So the man that you were going to see in the film is an old man who's now 82 years old. And he lives in a town called Forest, Mississippi, and that's Donald. He's still here with us, the first child ever diagnosed with autism. And we spent time with him, and his story is so encouraging and so remarkable that though the whole saga of autism has a lot of ups and downs and some very dark episodes, Donald's story is beautiful and encouraging and inspiring. So the beginning of the book is Donald's childhood, and the last chapter of the book is whatever happened to Donald, and the good news is that it's great news.
Yes. Maybe we shouldn't reveal the ending. Maybe that was a blessing in disguise. Now people can take the book home and find out what happened to him and, yeah, you know, the life that he does lead, in large part due to the efforts of his parents that did pull him out of that institution and allow him to live at home in an era where that was frowned upon and discouraged, actively discouraged. And that lens of parents is throughout the book, And can you tell us a little bit about why you chose that as the vehicle to tell the history?
Well, I mean, you know, Cari, you're a parent of a child with autism. You know that you will do anything for your son, and that means anything. And our book is a story about parents who would do anything at a time when they had to do everything, when there was no support. The things that we discovered about the practical challenges faced by families, even in my lifetime, I was born in 1955. In 1955, if a child was diagnosed with autism and brought to a pediatrician or psychiatrist, more likely, the parents were told a few things, absolutely told a few things. And the first thing was, institutionalize this child and then try to forget about it. Move on with your life. Have other children. Have quote-unquote normal children. There's nothing that can be done, and it shouldn't be your responsibility or your burden. The state will take care of them. And so many, many families did that, and not because they didn't love their children. And it's interesting, Karen, my co-author, who's the mother of a son, when we started researching this, became furious at these parents who did this back in the 50s and the 60s, until she got to learn their stories and realize what kind of pressure they were under. And it was eye-opening to us to realize how readily society said that if somebody was different, they didn't belong in society, they should be put away. It was really a powerful impulse. Dr. Spock, we found in his 1947 edition of Dr. Spock's, I hope, still famous book on childcare, in the 500 pages, I think it was page 547, in the 1947 edition, he said that if a child were born in the hospital and it was apparent that the child had some sort of developmental disability, for example, Down syndrome, his advice right then was that the nurses should remove the child from the parents' care and put the child immediately into institutional care for life, and that the parents should go home without the baby. Mm. And he said, and do it quickly before the mother becomes attached to the child. Mm-hmm. In the following edition, he said, have this conversation with the father, because the mother can't, you can't have it with the mother. She'll fight you on it.
She would, yeah.
In the mid-1950s edition of the book, all of that was gone. That vanished. So something was beginning to change. But the other thing we found was that if you brought a child to the doctor in the mid-1950s, and by the way, well into the 1970s, and a mother said, my child's diagnosed with autism, what happened? What am I supposed to do? The mother would be told, without question, you failed to love your child enough, and that's why this has happened to your child. The child is withdrawing into his or her, usually boys though, his or her own world as a defense mechanism against your coldness. You've hurt the child that much in the first weeks of his life. Mm. And this was called the refrigerator mother. And these women were called refrigerator mothers. And that was so powerful that, not only did mothers have the challenge of raising children who needed an enormous amount of support, but they weren't given any support because they were being blamed. Karen tracked down women who are now in their 80s, who lived through this with children born in the 1960s. And they tell the story of trying to bring their children to hospitals, and this was set in New York, two incidents in New York that we found, where they were brought to clinics for autistic children. And the staff was so hostile to them, the staff was so convinced that the mothers had abused their children that they were treating them as abusers. And so one mother brought her daughter to this school after begging to get the child into the school. And the day she knocked on the door, it was on 77th Street in New York, and the door opened and arms stuck out, grabbed the child, pulled the child in, and slammed the door in the mother's face so that the mother wouldn't contaminate. Mm-hmm. So that's how powerful this crazy idea was. And the treatment for autism, quote-unquote treatment, that was prescribed, and you can still find this if you can dig up books from that period, intensive psychoanalysis for the mother, so that she could figure out what she had done wrong so that she could try to reverse it. And what that means, incidentally, is not only an awful lot of wasted time and energy and effort, but nobody was actually studying ways to help the children directly themselves for decades and decades. And this idea held on in this country well into the 1970s, and it's still very popular in parts of France today.
Still in France. Yeah. And yet it speaks to the it's ironic almost, it does speak to the love that the mothers had, that they would endure that therapy and they would subject themselves to it for the sake, what they believed would be, you know, the better interest of the child.
Yeah, they wanted to discover what they had done wrong. And there's one story, I'll tell a few stories from the book tonight. One of the stories is about a mother named Rita Tepper who lives today in Florida, and she's in her 80s. She has an adult son with autism. He was profoundly affected, her son Stephen. She was very well educated, which worked against her because it meant that she had read all of the books. She was actually a social worker, she had done psychology. So when her son was diagnosed, she immediately thought, oh no, he's got that thing that I've caused. And so she signed up for therapy and she went to group sessions and she saw progress will be made the day that I can figure out what I did. And so she was looking for this breakthrough. And she remembers the day she had the breakthrough. The doctor was asking her questions about the day that her son was born and the days after that. And she suddenly had this recollection of her first impression of her son. And her son was born, he was jaundiced, so his body was yellow, his skin was yellow, and he had blonde hair that was all sort of stuck together and sticking up in spikes. And he was a very, very thin child, very scrawny. She said to the doctor, oh my God, I know what it is. When I laid eyes on him, the thought that occurs to me is that this yellow, spiky kid looks like a chicken. No. And that's it. I thought of him as a chicken. It was a moment of rejection on my part, and that's what causes autism. And the sad thing in this story, it is laughable and sad at the same time. Mm. The sad thing is she thought that was progress. She was glad to have that. That's how deeply held this notion of the refrigerator mother theory was.
Yeah. Yeah, and I want to circle back to the institutionalization that you mentioned, because that was occurring here in Traverse City, and you're staying in what was the former state hospital, and there were children housed there, yeah. In what is now the TBA administration building. That was a boys' wing. And we don't know that there were children with autism there because, again, the diagnosis didn't exist, but likely there were.
Very, very likely. It's very hard. One of the great questions all of the time is there more autism today than there used to be? Or is it just that more people have the label now than are getting the label, and these people were missed in the past or overlooked or misdiagnosed? And one of the reasons that's a very hard question to answer is because the definition of autism has changed dramatically over time. And also, the diagnosis of autism is a rather subjective thing. There's no blood test for autism or cheek swab. It's not like that. It's a set of behaviors which are observed by an expert, an analyst, an evaluator, who then makes a judgment call about whether this is autism or not. And what that evaluator works off of is this checklist, but that checklist has changed many, many times. So that's one thing that confounds the question of whether there's more autism than before. But the other one is the fact, as you just said, people who had the diagnosis were not among us. They were put away. It's very, very likely, we think, that people who had autism were there, but they were in institutions. And we also think it's likely, to put it the way you did it, that if there were children in institutions in those days, did they have what today would be called autism? We think it's very, very highly likely that they were.
Right.
And all over the country. I mean, these, you know, they. I'm in... this setting now is such a beautiful place where I'm staying.
Mm-hmm.
It's gorgeous,
mm-hmm.
by the way. I do
right.
recommend it.
Right.
And it's a beautiful repurposing of a place that really tried hard. Traverse City and all of these state institutions, we did this research, they all started with the best intentions. They were called asylums because asylum means sanctuary. It means safe place. People seek asylum when they are fleeing war. They seek asylum. These were called asylums. And they were... all over the country, they were started mostly in the late 19th and early 20th century with the best of intentions. Why were they out in the country? Fresh air, to get away from the city. But eventually it became, they're out in the country to keep them away from people. And they became bigger and they became overstuffed with people and funding was cut. And then they became hidden. And enormously scandalous behaviors and abuses took place in these institutions where individuals had no voice.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when they became snake pits. And that persisted. You know, people were treated quite poorly. But that era ended very quickly and dramatically from the 1970s through the 1990s.
Right. And you talk about that, about the ending of that era, and what specifically happened then to the children with autism, and also to the refrigerator mothers. Can you walk us then through what finally caused a shift away from that blame game?
Well, and it was parents like you, the earlier generation of you, people who would not take no for an answer. Like Donald Triplett's mother, whose name is Mary, they just said, we're going to push back. And it wasn't easy. And it's very hard to push back with the medical institution, with the medical establishment, when they're telling you that you're part of the problem. But they did. They began to organize. They formed the first autism organization. Took place on a night in November 1965 at a house in Teaneck, New Jersey. 30 or 40 families got together in a house there. And the remarkable thing was that in that period, there are so many autism organizations now, so many. There were none. And a few different families got together. They met each other by chance. They communicated across the country by writing letters to each other because there was no internet and nobody could afford long-distance calls. Mm-hmm. Some people put ads in newspapers trying to find other families affected by autism. Very few people in the broader public had ever heard of autism. It's an interesting thing. We hear this story again and again and again from people from this era. They would tell their friends and families, they would try to explain what was going on in their house, and they would say, well, you see, my son, he's autistic. And again we hear the story, oh, he's artistic, congratulations, mm-hmm. That's so wonderful. That's how unfamiliar the word was, mm-hmm. Really kind of into the 1990s. So these families were so isolated from each other, and they were isolated in part because autism, as it was then defined, was something that was much more severe than today when the spectrum idea is here, that they were not welcome, their children were not welcome out in public. They were not allowed to go to school. That's a remarkable thing that people forget. Children with a developmental disability were not allowed to go to school. Some communities offered special education, but they weren't obliged to. And very often they could and usually did say, we wash your hands of your child. Those children were at home. Very often, one parent would have to stay home 24 hours a day. Very often, the children didn't sleep through the night, so the parent staying home was just run ragged. Their friends and relatives didn't understand. They would often say, well, why don't you just discipline that child? They were no Little League, no going to the movies, no going to restaurants. So it became a very, very isolating thing. So mm-hmm. on that night in Teaneck, New Jersey in 1965, people who were there told us that it was amazing that they found a community for the first time, other people who knew what they were going through mm-hmm. and who understood. And that's how isolated they were. And the founding of that group, which today exists as the Autism Society of America and it has chapters around the country, it's still there. That was the beginning of a pushback, and they began going to the press and publishing books and publishing their own research, and one of them, a father from San Diego named Bernard Rimland, demolished the refrigerator mother theory by pulling together research, and gradually it became an embarrassment that psychiatry had ever adopted that. But then the other thing they did was they fought to get their kids a right to education. Mm-hmm. They teamed up with other groups, like groups related to epilepsy. Children with epilepsy were also denied public education. Children with severe intellectual disability were denied public education. And they banded together and they forced the closing of the institutions by insisting on a right to public education. And the institutions couldn't provide the education. That's why the institutions began to shrivel, because the children were leaving and starting to go to school. And that all came about because of parents. And today, you know, every family, an individual who's on the autism spectrum and their families are still struggling and still needing support that is never quite sufficient for what they need. That's still true today. But at the same time, it's so much better than it used to be. And that's because of the work that was done by these parents in the 50s and the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, not only trying to change the law and not only trying to change society's sort of system, but trying to convince the rest of us to do the right thing, mm-hmm. which meant acceptance, which meant not being freaked out because there was somebody in a restaurant who was rocking it or making a noise, things that were just, get out of here, we don't want you here. They fought very hard to change our attitudes on that. And our book wanted to resurrect their stories. Some of these people are still alive, and they're very elderly, and their names are forgotten, and the battles they fought were tremendous, and it's sort of a stealth civil rights movement, really, really was.
Yeah.
And we wanted to give them credit for that. So the book's full of their stories. Women like, I mentioned Bernard Rimlin, and there's a mother named Ruth Sullivan, who's now in her 90s, who did so much work in upstate New York and then in West Virginia, and so many others. And they're the unsung heroes of this civil rights movement. And our view is that they are so inspirational that for people who are inside the autism community, we want their stories to be an inspiration to keep going.
Mm-hmm.
And then for everybody outside the autism community, what Karen and I refer to as the civilians, people who don't have a direct connection to autism,
mm-hmm.
But the civilian's part in the story is so critical because it was how everybody else decided to treat those who were on the spectrum. Has such a powerful influence on the kind of life they have and even on the kind of society we have and how proud we can be of ourselves as a society. We really wrote the book so that the civilians would read this story. We hope be drawn in by the quality of the stories and the writings, and we were so gratified when the Chicago Tribune said, oh my gosh, this book is like a movie, it's amazing, it's got, you know, heroes and villains, that a general audience would read the story just for the read, but then recognize, number one, what families and individuals go through, and number two, recognize that they have a part in the story by whether they were kind of the good guys.
Right.
Or not. And it's our feeling that once people know the story, they'll want to be the good guys. And Karen's son, who's now 22, is going to need support for the rest of his life. One of Karen's great questions, and this question of every, not just autism, every parent of a child with a disability is, when I'm gone, who's going to have my child's back as an adult? And the answer is, it's got to be the community. It's got to be an attitude. It's got to be that everybody wants to pull, is going to have to be rooting for the person with the challenge. And so we wrote the book to get to that broader community so that they'll be on the right side when the time comes. Just a very short example, if Karen were here, she would tell this story. Her son is named Mickey, he's 22. He grew up in New Jersey, but he's now attending a program in Phoenix where he's being taught how to, things like cook for himself and shop for himself and bathe the right way and wash his clothes and hold down a job and things like that. But he's 22 years old. Karen had to fly him back and forth on breaks from Newark, New Jersey to Phoenix. But they finally taught him how to fly himself, mm-hmm. by himself. That's mm-hmm. huge,
yeah.
huge. And he's got all sorts of quirky, you know, sort of autistic demands, like he needs to sit next to a window seat, and so that all gets arranged. But if last summer they drove him out to Newark to fly back home, everything was good, she and her husband. And when he was checking in, the agent checking him in asked him a question, not a tricky question, but some question about his luggage or something like that. And when he answered her, he has a sort of flat, monotonic voice. But the real thing is he didn't look her in the eye. He didn't make eye contact. It's very difficult for a lot of people with autism to make eye contact. He didn't make eye contact. So she wouldn't let him get on the plane because she thought this kid's a threat.
Mm-hmm.
This man's a terrorist of some
dear.
Kind. And it turned into a very, very big scene at the airport. Which,
yeah,
again, Karen tells it with a sense of humor now, but the painful thing was she said, if I lose it here, he's definitely not going to get on the plane.
Right.
But if I don't fight for him, he's definitely not going to get on the plane. And so she had to figure that out. Now, Karen called me that day. She was crying, and she said, this woman is so ignorant, and how could she do that? And I said, maybe ignorant's a harsh word. It sounds as though it's willful. She doesn't get it. And that's what the book is for. If that woman were to read this book, she would do the right thing. I don't think she was a bad person, by the way. By the way, what she finally did was Karen distracted the woman while her husband walked Mickey to security and pushed him through.
Uh-huh.
And he was on his way to the plane and everything was okay. But then Karen, if you knew Karen, she's a little bit spunky, wanted to do this to the woman and said, it's okay, don't worry, he's on his way to the plane. The woman freaked out, went running through security, pulled him off the plane, pulled him back through the gate. Now, the painful thing in this is that is so disorienting to Mickey, who had learned how to do everything. What he didn't know what he was doing wrong. Finally, a very senior security person came and asked Mickey a few questions and said, I'll tell you what. He said to the parents, I'll tell you what. I'll let him get on the plane if the flight attendant, if the head flight attendant is okay with it. And the head flight attendant was fine with it. So she hadn't read our book, but she's the kind of person we want to have read our book. Right. That's the message we get. She said somewhere in her experience, it was clear Mickey was different, but she knew how to roll with it. So yeah. That's kind of what we're trying to get across.
I'm actually, while that's quite a saga, and I certainly am glad I was not in Karen's shoes that day, and I'm sorry it was so heart-wrenching, I'm sure, for her and for Mickey. I'm actually kind of glad to hear about that experience being told to the audience, because the prevailing image in most of popular culture about autism today is that it's a minor impairment. I'm thinking of Max on Parenthood. Some of those in the audience may have seen Life Animated, which is the Oscar-nominated documentary shown at the Traverse City Film Festival this last year, about their son who lives independently, or that people with autism are artistic and they have some kind of savant skill, and that they kind of get along just fine, and that picture, that image of the more severely impaired person who really dominate in the numbers doesn't get seen so much.
Well, that's a result of the concept of an autism spectrum, which is an idea that didn't only really took hold in the 1990s and forward to today. Prior to that, to have an autism diagnosis, you had to be very, very severely impaired, such as my brother-in-law in Israel. He's somebody who could never, he needs help going to the bathroom and getting dressed and things like that. But at the same time, by the way, he can paint beautifully. And I think he's a very content person, but he needs that kind of support. And he was diagnosed in the early 1970s. And to have a diagnosis of autism then, you really had to be severely impaired. But the idea began to grow and spread that autism was autistic traits. And I've always thought that autism is not a very good noun, but it's a pretty decent adjective, because the noun makes it sound like it's one thing. Whereas the adjective says it's something like this. It's kind of like the word feverish. You can be feverish for all kinds of reasons and to all kinds of degrees, but nobody ever says that feverism is its own condition. And so autistic traits like being unable to make eye contact, having repetitive language, or having an obsessive interest, not being able to read people's social cues, those sorts of traits can show up in all kinds of degrees in all kinds of people who can get along in society to all kinds of ways, to not at all to quite highly. And the idea of the autism spectrum was to group all these people together and say, well, there's a spectrum from very, very intense to very, very mild traits. And there were very good reasons for that concept to come into focus. And that is that people who were more able to get along in life nevertheless had really severe challenges. So you can be a professor, I'm making this up, there isn't such a person, but I'm theoretically a professor at MIT who is a mathematical genius who is unable to sustain a relationship, a romantic relationship or even friendships, because of problems with the social cues. And that's very isolating and very lonely and very crushing. And that's a real thing. But, and it's called autism today. It wouldn't have been before. It's lumped together now with people like my brother-in-law and other individuals who will need to wear diapers for the rest of their lives, and who will need 24-hour care for the rest of their lives. Those are all sort of lumped together. What's happened is that the story, and in a good way it's good because it helps to destigmatize autism, the news media and Hollywood have been attracted to the people at that end where there's much more independence, because they're fascinating individuals, they're inspiring individuals, sometimes they're huge contributors to society, people who are doing very, very important work. And they do have a story of being oppressed and bullied, and there's sympathy for that. So the limelight has moved towards that group of people, like the ones you're talking about in the movies and places like that. And it has started to move off of the people who are far more challenged in the most basic ways. And So that's the downside. We think that that's the problem with the autism spectrum concept, is it tends to shift. And Karen and I, we've been reporting on autism for television for 17 years. And we've looked back at our stories, and we realized that we ourselves, when we've gone into a school to shoot a story about some particular theme, maybe about a therapy, or maybe about, we did a story about bullying once, we have almost always looked for the child who could talk best to us, mm-hmm. because we're doing television and we need to do an interview. And so we are guilty of making that choice of the most articulate child,
right.
and not the one in the corner who's staring off into a space that we can't quite fathom, because that would be a hard interview. Mm-hmm. And in the book, we decided to address that. And so the book tells many, many more stories of people who are much more challenged, and that's the blessing of not having to do television. So it's a really complex topic that you're touching on, but you're right. Autism is, if we're going to say it's a broad spectrum, we have to acknowledge it's a broad spectrum, and it's hard to say that this is autism and that's not autism nowadays.
Right. And you talk in the book about the history of the lumpers and the splitters,
right.
and how that trend has vacillated back and forth. And now we're in a lumper phase,
right.
Where everyone, and there is, in fact, just one spectrum now. The official diagnostic criteria changed a couple years. There's no such thing technically anymore as Asperger's,
right.
which many in the audience might have heard. And there's... And from my perspective, you know, as a parent, actually, I also like the lumper concept. I'm interested in more people. With more people comes more clout, comes more awareness, mm-hmm. And specifically, the whole idea of the label of autism in a school setting brings with it services.
Yeah.
And yeah. So can you talk a little bit about that, about, again, touching how the destigmatization has gone so far as to maybe even be sought out in some situations?
Yeah, it's an interesting thing that 35 years ago, even though very few people had heard of autism, if their child was given the diagnosis, the news was considered devastating, because the description of the condition was for something so severe and apparently unaddressable that it seemed like, well, this, my child's life is ruined, and maybe our family's life is ruined because it's autism. It was this heavy thing. And now it's actually the case that parents of kids who have different challenges seek the label of autism for their child, because the campaign by parents to get the school systems to respond to autism was so well fought and successful that schools are better at responding to autism than to other things now. And so if you can get your child into an autism class, that child's going to get a better education than in some of the other classes. I'm not talking about typical versus children with disability now, but within the group of children who are disabled. So there are clinicians who acknowledge that the parents come in and they don't think that the child necessarily fits the diagnosis. It's not quite the thing. There's another box that they could fit them in, but the parents plead with them to make the diagnosis autism, so that the services will be available. And that's another thing. And by the way, that's not an accusation. I have no idea if that's a widespread thing or not. I'm talking about isolated incidents. But what it shows is the shift in the attitude towards this label, which was once just dreaded. And now the destigmatization, it's actually more the key to services. And it's one more thing that sort of indicates, is it hard, can we really say there's more autism than before when the label can be moved around so quickly like that?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, I remember when Owen was first diagnosed, and the way they work it here is it's usually the red flag is raised in the school, and the teacher recommended that we have him evaluated. And they send kind of like a front person to do the preliminary investigation to determine if they should then do a more thorough one. So the first person comes to our home, and you know, and I thought this was good, that you know, this is the situation he's most comfortable and at ease in, and you know, we're gonna, you know, kind of sail through this. And so she spent quite some time, and then I said, well, you know, so what do you think? Do we need to do the more thorough investigation? And she said, yeah, I think you do. And there was that sinking feeling, because you didn't know what you might be encountering, but you knew it wasn't going to be what you expected. But then we got on to but it was still our choice. I'd recommend that you do this more thorough evaluation. It is your decision whether you choose to or not. And I said, well, we are kind of worried about the label that he might get. And her answer, I thought, was so on target. And she said, people are already labeling him, and you want to make sure that they label him correctly.
Yeah, yeah.
So that he will get the service he needs.
An interesting thing, though, about labels is that when Karen and I met up with Donald Triplett finally, it was back in 2007, and it's an interesting story how we found him ultimately. We knew from the medical literature that what his birth date was and exact birth date and what town he was in, and I was doing some internet research trying to match those figures up, and Karen actually found an old phone book for this town of Forest, and she was calling everybody whose name began with a T, because we knew his last name began with a T, because that's what it said in the medical literature, was case one, Donald T. She's calling everybody named T and not getting through to anybody, and finally I said, I think I might get the number, why don't you try this one, and she tried it, and she got an answering machine, and the answering machine said, hello, happy spring, and happy summer, and merry, merry Christmas, and have a wonderful 2007. And Karen calls me up and says, we got the guy. I know this is the guy. And so, in fact, we didn't know for sure.
Right.
But what we didn't want to do after he had lived in anonymity, and that's where I'm coming back to the questions of labels, he had been living in anonymity for all of these decades. We didn't want to just knock on his door, so we found intermediaries. I have some friends who work as newspapermen, a newspaperman who works in Mississippi, and I asked him if he knew anybody in this town, and he did, and that guy knew a member of the family, and we called a member of the family, and at these stops, as we called each of these people to ask for an introduction to Donald, three times we heard the same thing from people, which was, you know, they would take a look at these two Yankees and say, I remember one guy literally said, now I'm a redneck. I don't know what you're up to.
With your TV camera.
Yeah, with your TV camera. I'll introduce you to Donald. I'll introduce you, but if you hurt him in any way, we know where to get you. And this was our first inkling of what actually happened in Donald's life after the medical literature ended. And what it turns out is that people in Forest, Mississippi had no idea what his label was. They didn't know that he had autism. They didn't know he had autism until we went down there and wrote an article about it in 2010. They just knew that he was different. And the astounding thing was that in this community, that protectiveness that we encountered, that had been his whole life. This community had really embraced this child who was very, very unlike the other children. And then he had become a teenager, and then he'd become a young adult, and then he'd become an old man. And what we found with Donald's life, the way it turned out, was so spectacularly good. Now, he had clear advantages. He was living in this little town, and the fact that his parents had the wherewithal to get him up to Johns Hopkins University has to do with the fact that his parents were both college educated, his father was a Yale law school graduate, and his mother was wealthy. Her grandfather owned a bank, had started the one bank in town, so they had money and they had know-how. And maybe it was because of that, but the community sort of got the message that you weren't supposed to pick on Donald, you were mm-hmm. supposed to accept him. And his parents, once they pulled him out of the institution and brought him back home, began to bring him to social events. They began injecting him into the society in this small town, and they could get away with that. I said before, so many parents were taught to be ashamed. They decided, we're not going to be ashamed, and we're going to show that we're not ashamed. And the community picked up on this. And there was no right to public education, but his mother went down to the local school principal, who was an old friend, and said, I want my son going to school here. And the principal said, okay, and the principal went to the first grade teacher and said, make this work. And so Donald got to go to school. Now, he was left behind a number of times, but always moved forward eventually, so that after several years, he was several years behind the other kids, but he kept moving forward. And by the time we caught up with him, he had had a great life, and he had grown so much so that he had learned how to converse, because we could have conversations, not great conversations, but we could have conversations with him. And he had developed things that he liked. He had developed social relationships. Now, he still lived on alone as an old man, but he has a brother living nearby. He plays golf every day. And I'm putting that up, he plays every day. That's what the video was going to show, was an old man playing golf. He drives a car, Cadillac, into the ground. Every 10 years, he gets a new one. He travels around the world in a very, very specific way. He calls a travel agent and he books a trip for 6 days to someplace in the world. And then he comes back on the sixth day, partly because he likes to go to church and Bible study, and also partly because it's an autistic pattern. He doesn't really interact with people along the way, but he likes to see the things he's seen in books and online, and he takes pictures and then he organizes them in photo albums, and he has a computerized system. He's very fascinated with numbers, and he's got this real, you know, what I'm describing is a guy with a Cadillac who gets to play golf every day in his senior years. I mean, that sounds like what everybody's aiming for, you know?
He's got to figure it out.
Yeah, and so what we tried to do was we started talking to people, interviewing them about the years before, all of the years we had missed. Like, what went on in this town that this kid could do so well? Because we know that Dr. Connor, who wrote that article in 1943 about 11 children, and Donald was the first, he followed up on the kids for a number of years. Of the 11, 9 spent the rest of their lives in institutions. Donald got out. Got into this place where everybody protected and embraced and sort of celebrated him. And when I say celebrated him, I mean, as a result of our book, he's like a celebrity there now. Uh-huh. I mean, they just gave him Citizen of the Year a few months ago.
Okay.
And Donald had this really wonderful outcome. And our theory is because of the community embracing him, because we talked with all of these people who have known him a long, long time, and they all say, you know, he's a genius. That's the story. He's different. He's odd, but he's a genius. And we would say, what do you mean? They say, well, he's got all these things with numbers. He's so good with numbers.
He can count the bricks.
The bricks is the famous story. There's this the legend about Donald Triplett is that. And everybody told us this story when we met him. Oh, you're doing a story about Don Triplett. You know, he counted the bricks in the high school building back in 1951. What do you mean? Well, he looked at the building, and we asked. The story goes like this: that one day, in 1951-52, Donald was in high school. He was older than the other kids. He walks out of the doorway of Forest High School, which is a building's no longer there, but we looked at photographs of it. It was this massive red brick building, about a block long, two stories high, no windows except the doorway. And Donald, the story goes, walked through the doorway, and he is surrounded by a group of boys, and they say, Donald, you're so good with numbers. Why don't you tell us how many bricks are in the side of the building? And the story goes that Donald looked over his shoulder for like 4 or 5 seconds and looked around at it, and then he turns back to the boys, and he tosses out the number, and they are flabbergasted, and they run off, and they tell their friends, and their friends told their friends, and those friends grew up and had children, and they told their children, so that by the time we got there, yeah, everybody in town said, oh, you're those Yankees doing this story about Donald, you know about the bricks. So, we put that in the Atlantic, an article we wrote for the Atlantic magazine about him in 2010, but we also put in the second part of that story. Karen one day sits down with Donald and says, Donald, boy, the whole thing with the bricks that day, how did you know how many bricks there were in the building? And he said, I didn't. I made it up. And at first we thought, well, that blows up that great story. But yeah. Then Karen said, why? And he said, I wanted the boys to like me. And then went into the story as like, okay, people make a lot of assumptions about the internal motivations and feelings of people with autism, and sometimes it's a bad stereotype that they're not interested in human connection. And he was clearly showing us he was interested in human connection. So that story, you know, really kind of captures for us. I mean, there were so many funny things We can move on to something else if you want.
I'll tell my own little story that about the human connection, because that is such a stereotype of, you know, the autism unto oneself, mm-hmm. and not interested in the human connection. And you know, my son likes books, and likes to be read to, and he's also echolalic, and we were talking about that at dinner a little bit, and that
we should explain what echolalic means, though.
Yeah. Right, echolalia is where you repeat back scripts, something you've read, a movie that you've seen, you know, often in, you know, very, very intimate, accurate detail, you know, to the point of reciting credits. And one of the books that we read is "I Love You All the Time." And it's a very young child, but it's been a favorite. And so it's two bears, and the mother bear tells the son bear, you know, how she loves him when she's at work, when she's with her friends, when she's angry with him, when it's raining, when it's sunny, you know, and even when you can't see me. It's a tuck-in story at the end. And after every different situation, the rejoinder is, "I love you all the time." And so Owen has said, "I love you," but recently he started saying, "I love you all year." And to me, that's his little riff on "I love you all the time."
That's
"I love
big
you
news.
All year." So, yeah. So, you know, it's heartwarming, of course, to hear it. But I think that that's so true, that that individuals with autism, they do want connection.
Yeah. Yeah, totally.
Yeah. So we're talking here, and we're going to try to recap here. Now, remember, you know, this is like a 500-page book, so you're definitely going to have to buy it, and we can't cover all the ground here in just an hour, but we have talked about Dr. Connor and Donald Triplett and the first diagnosis, and we've gone through refrigerator mother and the dispensation, thank you, of refrigerator mother, and the fight for public education for children with disabilities, specifically with children of autism. So let's move into a little bit more of a modern era, the 80s, 90s. And you said something also earlier today that was fascinating to me. You had considered not including the whole vaccine controversy in your book, which is probably, you know, the most well-known sub-story of autism. And so tell us about that decision.
Well, the it's in the book.
Yes.
And it's in the book because our editor said, the public will wonder, where is the vaccine story in your book? Mm-hmm. The reason that we considered skipping over it, or wish that we could, is that in the end we consider it an aberrational side diversion from the main story. And for us, the main story is this story of society gradually becoming more accepting, coming more to terms, the development of the science to understand what autism is about, the increasing assertion of people who are on the autism spectrum to speak for themselves, the gradual embracing of the topic of autism by the arts, by movies and things like that. And then in the middle of this is this very, very intense story that in our view is burned out by the fact that the science ultimately didn't support the notion that vaccines cause autism when looked at the epidemiological level. And we took that view. We wanted to see what the science said, and while there are still certainly people who are convinced with all goodwill and intellectual honesty on their part that vaccines caused autism in their children, the fact is that we know that when the picture was looked at very, very broadly through epidemiological studies, it just didn't hold up. And so we considered, you know, maybe just covering it in two pages and saying that. But then we ultimately yielded to the fact that, in fact, it was a big, big chapter in the public's awareness of autism. And what we ended up saying was that while the science doesn't support the notion that there is an autism epidemic caused by vaccines, and in fact, it's not even clear there is an autism epidemic. It's not clear that there is one, and it's not clear that there's not one. Because of the things I was saying before, the definition has changed so much, it's hard to compare the past and the present, and there are so many things that confound the counting of who's autistic and who's not, that it's hard to say whether there's more or not. So that while the science doesn't support the notion that there's an autism epidemic caused by vaccines, what did happen is that the general public, the civilians, finally started caring about autism. around 2000 and 2001 and 2002, when the media was full of stories asking the question, will your child get autism from a vaccine? And there had been autism awareness campaigns and telethons before, and even the movie Rain Man had explored autism. It was still true that most of the public wasn't familiar with the term and didn't care about it. The vaccine story gave them a reason to care about it. It was a very, very, very important social phenomenon. The vaccine scare is what we decided, and that's how we write it up in the book.
Okay. And I'll ask you to touch on one more kind of current theme in the autism conversation before I ask you to read, and that's the idea of neurodiversity. And you touched on it just a second ago.
Yeah, neurodiversity is both controversial and non-controversial. And if you're not familiar with the term, what it really is a philosophy that promotes the idea that, and very broadly, it promotes the idea of acceptance and even celebration of all of the different ways that people present in the world neurologically, from what's called typical, which means, you know, the less politically correct word for that is normal in quotation marks, but typical, the way that most people are. And neurodiversity is a campaign of a worldview that says, let's stop making typical be normal, and you have to be typical to be good, you have to be typical to be considered whole. And if you're not, you're considered broken. Let's accept the idea that everybody's different. And some people are going to be autistic in their behaviors, and that's okay. That's fine. And they deserve acceptance. And in a way, the whole campaign that parents fought from the 1950s, 60s onward was a campaign for acceptance. They wanted their kids to get support. They wanted their kids to be accepted. They wanted their kids to be out of institutions. They wanted their kids to be in school. But the neurodiversity, some parts of the neurodiversity argument take this thought further, and it resists, it's a philosophy that resists the effort to change people who are autistic into being or looking or acting more typical. It's a campaign that resists the idea of trying to cure autism, if such a thing were even possible, which, by the way, I don't think it is. And that argument is that leave us alone. We're, you know, and a lot of people who are on the spectrum and have the diagnosis say this. And we have friends who do. John Robison is a famous guy, an author, and a great friend of ours. Alex Plank is another. Leave us alone. Cut us a break. Don't pick on us. Don't bully us. Don't discriminate us against jobs. But don't expect us to be different from the way we are to get all of those things. And that's an argument of the neurodiversity community. Where the tension comes in is on this question about a cure. Because there are people like my brother-in-law, who I've described already. I do believe he's content, but his opportunities in life have been incredibly narrowed by the fact that he has autism. He lives in a facility where the doors have to be locked because he and the other people like him, if they were able to wander out the doors at will, would be run over by cars very quickly or taken advantage of or abused due to their naivete and inability to navigate the world. And by the way, they wouldn't be able to figure out how to get a meal when they were hungry. They would be that impaired. And my mother-in-law, who in Israel, by the way, is a very, very noted campaigner for the rights of autistic people. She started Israel's first autism school back in the 1970s. My mother-in-law would certainly like her son not to have had those limitations. Mm-hmm. If she could have had a magic wand waved or a pill taken for him, her son, that would make those limitations go away, she would have done it because she sees the limitations in his life. And so there's a tension, and it exists today in the conversation in the neurodiversity argument between those who say, let's just celebrate autism, give support. They're not arguing against support. Let's celebrate and support, but not change, versus parents who have, and this is where the fact that their stories are beginning to be not told so much of the more severely affected people, versus, you know, families in those situations who would desperately want that kind of autism to stop being part of their children's lives. So we touch on that in the back part of the book, actually.
Yeah, okay. All right, I think that brings us up to the present. Ending with neurodiversity, and I wanted to ask you to read a passage now before we go to the Q&A.
Sure, and yeah, this is a passage that comes near the end of our book, and speaking of reading something that you wrote. I was so impressed by Rebecca at the beginning tonight. I just wanted to say that one more time. I spent some time with the Front Street Writers Group today, and they're an impressive bunch of kids. And I need to say that if I were Rebecca's age, no matter what I had written, I would never have in a thousand years have had the nerve to get up and read it. And it was so beautiful and fantastic. So
she did great.
As I've said, you know, our purpose in writing this book, for people who are inside the autism community, it's your story. It's the part of the story maybe you don't know, and we hope that it's a source of inspiration. But as I've said, it's a book that we want to break out from the autism community to the civilian world. So our goal is, you know, if to get people who are in the autism world to buy the book and give it to somebody on the outside to make the point to them that they are part of the story, that their attitudes have so much impact on what happens to people in the community. And so in the back part of the book, we tell a story that we hope will capture that. And we describe a scene that took place on a bus in New Jersey in 2007. And what happened was there was a young man with autism, whose name is Nicholas, and he was a teenager. He didn't look like a child anymore. He wasn't a cute kid. And we haven't talked about this, but one of the huge challenges right now is for adults with autism. We've come a long way, and this book tells a story of learning to support children with autism. We haven't figured out nearly what to do to support adults with autism. And part of that reason is that, again, their parents are gone and can't fight for them, and people are scared of them, and so that's sort of the next frontier that our book looks forward to. So Nicholas looked like an adult, and he had a teacher named Pete Gerhart, who had been teaching him how to ride public transportation. And that's because public transportation, first of all, is a big challenge for somebody as impaired as, again, my brother-in-law, or Karen's son, or this young man, Nicholas. But if you can learn how to get around, boy, does that open your life up. So it's a real priority to teach somebody on the spectrum who can't use the buses how to use the buses. And Pete had been teaching him how to do this. Nicholas couldn't speak. He didn't have language. And he wasn't very sophisticated in the ways of the world. So they had spent weeks teaching him step by step. Here's where you go. This is what a bus stop looks like. That's the sign. That's how you read the sign. Here's how you stop the bus. When the bus stops, wait for the door to open. Get on. Stand in line. Take out your money. Put it in. Find your seat. Wait for your stop. Ring the bell. All of these little steps had to be taught to him in very, very small increments. And Pete Gerhart had been sitting next to Nicholas in the beginning, but as the weeks had gone by, he had started to move a few seats back and a few more seats back and a few more seats back. And the other thing that was happening is that they were riding the same route back and forth. So there were a lot of regulars on the route who saw them and kind of got used to them. But one day, the bus came to a stop, and Nicholas is alone in the front seat, and Pete's way in the back, and two guys get on the bus who hadn't been on this route before. And they sit down behind Nicholas. And Nicholas, as the bus starts moving, starts rocking back and forth in his seat. That's a classic autistic trait. And he starts flipping his fingers like that, another classic autistic trait called stimming. And he begins to vocalize. I'm using the word vocalize to mean he's making sounds, but he's not using words. And this really, really began to bother these two guys who sat down behind him. Mm-hmm. And they began to bully him. And they leaned into him. And they start saying, you know, hey, man, like, what's your problem? What's wrong with you anyway? And what I'm going to read is what happened next. To Gerhart, that's the teacher again in the back, to Gerhart, the words sounded threatening. Now he was moving toward the front of the bus, trying to reach Nicholas before the situation flew out of control. Suddenly, a different passenger stood up, blocking the way. Gerhart didn't know him, but after all these weeks spent riding around with Nicholas, he realized he had seen him before. The man approached the bullying passengers, and according to Gerhart, he said to them, "What's his problem? He's got autism. So what's your problem? How about you shut up?" There was a tense silence and a whiff of threatened violence in the air. But the bullies must have sensed that everyone else on the bus had just lined up behind Nicholas. They shrugged, and then they left him alone. Gerhart was stunned. He was also elated. That bus on that route, he realized, had become one of those impromptu communities he wanted the world to see. No introductions had been made, but a familiarity had risen among the regulars, the dozen or so passengers who took that same route at the same time every day. Just as in Forest, Mississippi, a neighbor had decided that the odd man out was, in fact, one of us, simply part of the group. It happened on a bus in New Jersey. It can be that way anywhere.
In Traverse City. Thank you. Thank you very much.
I always get, I cry a lot. I almost got there on that moment, but fortunately I held it together.
Yeah, don't, that's definitely a happy ending. Definitely happy ending. We'd like to move to the question and answer period now. So they'll bring up the lights, and there are some roving mics on either side in either aisle. Everyone, if you want to raise your hand, and please state your name and then ask your question.
I had no idea so many people were here. Seriously, because we can't see. I am thrilled by this, so thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Mary Margaret. I live here in Traverse City, but I grew up in the Detroit area, and my brother should have been interviewed. My family could have been interviewed for this. My brother's 60. When he was about 4 years old, he was diagnosed. They labeled it schizophrenia. I don't even think they were using the word autism at the time. I even think they probably labeled my mother as a refrigerator mother. So my family experienced a lot of this. I've always tried to advocate for him, and my mother's still alive. She's 86 years old, living in the Detroit area. So I'm glad I came tonight. I'm still reading the book, but I definitely try to be a part of the community and try and advocate for autism or autistic people as well as people of difference. So,
thanks for
coming.
Thank
you. Thank you so much.
And for reading.
Yeah, thank you very much. Your talk was fascinating. I read your book a while ago. My name's Dave Olson. I happen to be a pediatrician in Traverse City. And I recall that in the 90s, there was a big flurry of activity about the notion of facilitated communication. And I think that's something that might be interesting to the audience if you could perhaps comment on facilitated communication. I still see that notion touted as something that's legitimate. I've seen some recent advertisements. Apple is advertising their iPad as a device that could be used for facilitated communication. And I think the audience may be interested in that. Could you comment on that just for a few minutes?
Yeah, it's a very rich topic, and we do write about it in the book. And it's a delicate topic as well. Facilitated communication was a technique that was developed in Australia in the late 1980s, in which a woman found a way to establish communication with an individual who did not, another woman, a young woman, who did not have autism, but she had various kinds of, as I recall, and I'm not saying that I'm reporting this accurately, but I believe she had various kinds of muscular dystrophy that impaired her ability to speak. She was institutionalized in a most brutal way. And this woman, Rosemary Crossley, took, felt empathy for her, and she paid a lot of attention to her, and she became quite convinced that this young woman had a lot to say. And she began working with the woman and holding her hand to sort of support it, as she would put it, only supporting it. And the young woman began pointing out letters on a keyboard, and the letters began to form words. And the story she told was that she had broken through what were basically physical barriers to her communication, which was that her body was rebelling against her ability to coordinate itself enough to form words, but she could do it with this support. She could do it with her hand.
That was the facilitation.
That was the facilitation of the communication. So what happened was, this idea came across to the United States, but it very quickly caught on in the autism world, that people began to hold the hands of people like my brother-in-law again, who really couldn't speak, although my brother-in-law does have some words. And not only were words being formed, but incredibly eloquent, full sentences were coming out of individuals, and these sentences were in some ways troubling. Like, why does everyone think that I'm stupid? And I'm in a prison here, help me get out. And my parents think that I'm an idiot and that I need more support from them. And I'll confess that ABC News 2020 was one of the shows that went nuts over this. Oh my gosh, these not just children, adults who couldn't speak are not only speaking, but people were starting to come out like writing poetry and things like that. And this thing caught on in 1990, 1991 here in a huge way, huge. Mm-hmm. A school was established at Syracuse University to teach it. Workshops popped up all over the country. School districts began to require that special ed teachers be versed in how to use facilitated communication. What nobody was really thinking through clearly was, wait a minute, who's writing this stuff? The child or the person moving the hand around?
The facilitator.
And what finally forced the resolution of this question was that in a number of cases, 50 or 60 cases, the message that began to come out is, my father's sexually abusing me. And all over the country, the messages were of sexual abuse. Fathers were arrested and put in jail for abusing their children because the police accepted this testimony. And it was defense attorneys who said, well, let's test this method. And they began to construct methods for testing facilitated communication in courtrooms, basically to get accused fathers exonerated. And they developed tests where they would, very, very simple when you think of them, if I were facilitating you, if I were the facilitator, they would put a board between us, and they would put in front of you a card that had a picture of a boat and show me a picture of a boat. And then they would ask you, what are you looking at? And I would be holding your hand and you would answer boat. Then they would change the next picture. You would see an apple and I would see an apple. They would say to you, what are you looking at? You would say apple. But then they put in front of you a motorcycle, and they put in front of me pizza. And they ask you, what are you looking at? And the answer came out, pizza. The answer came out the thing that the facilitator was seeing. And it happened again and again and again. And these cases were thrown out of court and facilitated communication was considered discredited. But it became a huge thing. Now, I need to say that, and it's true with everything with autism. It's true in terms of the vaccine theory, et cetera. There are still people out there practicing facilitated communication who believe that there's actually something going on. And Karen and I take the position in the book that we're never going to rule out that there are exceptions to everything. But what's happened with autism is it happened with the vaccine thing is it becomes the case that people buy into the notion that the whole thing is true and it's true for everybody. And so it's a heartbreaking story for a couple of reasons. And one of them is not only what happened to this abuse, but the facilitators weren't lying. The facilitators had convinced themselves that it was working.
They were believers.
And the other thing is that the beautiful part of the story of facilitated communication is that it helped people grasp the humanity of the child more than they were willing to before, once they thought that there was a person recognizable on their terms.
Trying to get out.
And so parents told us, you know, I used to talk about my child like he wasn't there. We would be having conversations and refer to my child as him or her. But I couldn't do that once I knew that there was somebody in there. We started talking to them and it became you. And then once it was blown up, it was realizing that they had done this, and they didn't want to go back to talking about somebody in third person again. So in a sense, it was about a dream for the idea that there was a person in there who would be, again, quote unquote, dangerous word, normal, trying to get out, as opposed to somebody who was truly different. And then going back to the idea that wasn't true, but still kind of recognizing a humanity of the person. So in that sense, it kind of had a good thing. Now, you mentioned the iPads and those kinds of things. I haven't seen the Apple ad. But there is a second level to this, and that is that people with who don't have language but do have autism have been able to communicate in very rudimentary ways using, there's a system called PECS where they exchange pictures of things that they need, and the iPad has sped that process up. And we think that that's real, that they're learning through a sort of behavioral approach that, you know, that picture or that word means that thing, and if they're trained to, that picture means that thing, that becomes a lesson for them, and they can begin to use that to, it eases their world. You can through behaviorism teach a child who can barely speak to form words and form some simple words. And even if a child only gets 10 words, if one of them is pain or hurts and another one is water, that's a huge breakthrough as opposed to silence. And the iPads are allowing for that level and somewhat more sophisticated level of communication, but that's not the poetry that facilitated communication was portraying. And so the overall sense on facilitated communication is that it was a heartbreaking moment of hoax that goes to the and it was really the pain of parents wanting to get the sense that they could communicate with their children in a way. And we write in the book, I went online and Googled a phrase, a collection of phrases, autism, last night I dreamt, and I found so many hits that said, last night I dreamt my child could talk. And that's, you know, that's really what's at the heart of that desire. And so it's another story we try to tell with respect to the people who believed in and still believe in facilitated communication, is that wish and that dream is so powerful.
Right. And what you were just saying there about behavioral techniques reminded me, again, we went so fast, we didn't even touch on any of the history of behaviorism, but that is all in the book as well, and that's what our sponsors tonight, the Autism Centers, do, so visit their table back there. And another question. Susan.
Welcome, John, from Michigan Writers.
Thank you.
And I'm a college professor, and I have a student who is on the spectrum. She graduated college, she has a job, she drives, she has a boyfriend, she's really engaged in life. Her mother happens to be here tonight, and my student couldn't be here, but she wrote something she wanted me to read to the audience. So I'm gonna have my colleague hold the mic real quick here. Actually, she wrote quite a bit, but I'll be brief. Yes, when I was first diagnosed, I was a younger person, though autism and intelligence were mutually exclusive, unless you were a savant, and I was neither of those, only above average at best. Nobody really knew what to do with me when I was mainstreamed, and I had some really bad behavioral issues due to my inability to communicate effectively. These problems go both ways, since not only my parents were suffering, but I was too, and the enemy was society and a system not fit for me. People, though, I would never amount to anything, but my parents believed in me despite all of this, and I was able to get the behavioral intervention I needed, even if it meant bringing someone from Lansing. Now there are insurance laws, and we have two wonderful autism centers in Traverse City, and I work at one of them, even though I was discouraged from pursuing a career in teaching people with developmental disabilities because it was like the blind leading the blind. But there are blind special ed teachers that teach Braille, so that analogy doesn't make sense. Nobody ever knew what would happen to adults with autism, and as the first mass diagnosed generation, the millennials get older people are seeing and paying attention to the challenges adults face. There is still uncharted territory I face, like I have no idea about marriage and motherhood or the long-term complications older adults with autism face, but I am willing to find out and set the way if necessary.
Okay, a couple, one in the front, one in the middle, in the back. One more? Okay.
Thank you very much, John, for all you and Karen have done.
My
name is Kathy Daniels, and my husband and I have a niece who has it, and also a grandson. And you mentioned Phoenix about that training center. I wonder if you know, and they happen to be in Phoenix, and I know a little bit about it, but not as much as I'd like to. And also, if there are other ones like that across the U.S. or beginnings of one, and I think there may even be a housing facility started in Phoenix. Do you know anything about that?
I know a lot about it.
Yay.
Because I did a piece for PBS about it. The broad answer to your question, as I said before, is that the response to supporting children once they become adults is really weak at this point and unthought out. In most states, children are supported through the age of 21. I only learned today that children in Michigan are supported through the age of 26. That's gigantic. That's a gigantic advantage. But what happens after that is that after all of this investment has been put into very, very, sometimes very expensive and painstaking therapy to help, like that story of Nicholas on the bus, if you expand the kind of work that went into that to all kinds of things in his life, that work takes years and lots of money. And it all stops when the child ages out of the system. So we sort of, when the kids are kids, we're sort of rooting for the idea of we're going to give them all the tools that they need to make it as adults. But then adulthood comes and all the tools are pulled away. And the problem is that individuals backslide. And a person who has social challenges and is isolated, if you don't have that kind of support and you tend to be isolated anyway, it's just going to increase and you're not going to get a job and you're not going to be able to keep a job and you're not going to have neighbors who want you in the neighborhood. You're not going to have support and you're not going to have friends. That's the most important thing, is having friends and friendship. And the program in Phoenix is called First Place, and it's just launching now. They just broke ground. And the idea there, it started by a woman named Denise Resnick, who's quite remarkable. And there are other isolated pockets of this sort of project going on. But the fact is they're all experimental. They're all first time. And I literally just said they just broke ground on December 6th in Phoenix. And that's because she has a son that she's been taking care of his whole life. And he's 27 years old now. And, you know, he now needs a place because she's, I'm guessing, in her late 50s, and she knows she's not going to be there forever. And the point of the project is to create a community in Phoenix where the whole community is sort of on board with the idea that there are going to be people in the community who are a little bit different, a little bit quirky, a little bit challenged, and we're going to need help and support for those challenges. They're going to need somebody to recognize them when they need help, like that airline attendant recognized that Karen's son, Mickey, just needed somebody to say, it's okay, I'm going to roll with it. And so she's constructing an apartment building, and it's funded, and that's always the issue, where's the money coming from? It's funded by private money and private donations and corporate donations. She's a real, real great networker at raising funding, but she's got this Phoenix, in our report, we call Phoenix the most autism-friendly city on earth, because it's a thing in Phoenix that it's cool to support the autism community. And businesses are stepping up all over the place. CVS and the Diamondbacks baseball team, they're all hiring people with autism. This has been 20 years of her doing this sort of number on the autism community. So the point of the community is not to house all the people who have autism together off in one place, but to create a series of apartments in the middle of town where some people have autism and some people don't, and some people are there to support people with autism and to help them out, and some people with very mild autism and people with much more challenging autism, to pull them all together. And we'll know in 10 to 15 years how it works out as a concept. But it costs a lot of money and it takes an awful lot of work. And it takes, this is that whole point about wanting to reach the civilians. And she's done it in Phoenix. We went to a breakfast, fundraising breakfast there, and like all the cool people in town were trying to get in. There were state senators and the big business owners wanted to be at this breakfast because it was a Denise Resnick autism event. You know, the whole community, everybody recognizes what it is, and people don't freak out if there's a guy flipping his fingers in front of his eyes in a restaurant at all. And and another thing Karen and I often say is that the essence of community support is compassion, and compassion is free. It costs nothing not to pick on the guy on the bus at all. And that's worked out there. And so that's what First Place is about. And there's a lot more about it online, or you can look at our PBS book. I think there's about to be a waiting list for it as word gets out about it. But Denise is hoping to expand that model to other communities. And other communities are doing other things. But that's the one that we know most about and that we've reported on. And Karen, after we reported on it, said, I want to see if this is going to be right for my son. And he started there about 4 months ago, and he's doing really well. The other day, he was flying back. I mentioned he needs to sit on a window seat. So this was a separate flying story, much more recently. He was in New Jersey flying back. She had called ahead, he's going to have a window seat, it's okay. She drops him off at the airport, gets through security with no problem. She goes out to the parking lot, the phone rings. He has a cell phone, he talks a lot. He calls her several times a day. He's 22 years old and she still takes every call. That's part of the story of being a parent. And she says, what's wrong? He says, I got a window seat. So, it doesn't have a window. You know those seats where there's one? And here's the nice thing about the story. She called me telling me this in such great excitement, and you have to know what the challenges are to get the excitement, but she said, so I said, well, she said, oh no, it's gonna be a scene. He's gonna get kicked off because he might have a meltdown. And he says, put the flight attendant on, He said, no, it's okay, I'm gonna do it. He calls back a few minutes later and says, they changed the seat for me. And she said, it's the first time in his life that he's advocated for himself, that he went up and explained the situation, and they were able to accommodate it. That is huge.
That is huge
if you're somebody like that. So, yeah.
Good for Mickey.
Yeah. Good for Mickey, but being in this program in Arizona kind of gave him some muscles to do this kind of thing. So, again, if you like our book and you're in the community, get one to somebody who's outside and tell them it's a good read, because it is. The Chicago Tribune said it's like a movie. And by the way, we're working on getting a film version made of it. That's something that took us 7 years to make the book, but movies take like twice as long, but we're hoping that'll happen.
All right, so stay tuned. And John will sign books out in the lobby afterwards, so please make your way out there, and maybe you can speak to more individually. And thank you so much for being here, John.
Thank you so much, and also to the Autism Centers of Michigan for having us.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you both for being here.